sahanavavatu, sahanau bhunaktu, saha viryam karavavahai, tejasvinavaritamastu ma vidvishavahai.
To familiarize ourselves, we'll chant the first page as well. We'll start from the beginning. I am Atma.
I am Atma.
Sarvesham Bhutanam.
Sarvesham Bhutanam.
Madhu. Asya Atmanah.
Asya Atmanah.
Sarvani Bhutani Madhu.
Sarvani Bhutani Madhu.
Yaschayam.
Yaschayam.
Asmin Atmani.
Asmin Atmani.
Tejo Mayah.
Tejo Mayah.
Amrita Mayah.
Amrita Mayah.
Purushah.
Purushah.
Yaschayam Atma.
Yaschayam Atma.
Tejo Mayo.
Tejo Mayo.
Purushah,
purushah,
ayameva sah,
ayameva sah,
yoyam atma,
yoyam atma,
atma idam amritam,
atma idam amritam,
idam brahma,
idam brahma,
idagam sarvam,
idagam sarvam.
So this we have seen in great detail over many visits, I think. And what we have seen here is that this Atma is, it is the definition of, from this side. Here. Because if you sit there, you will be behind the computer. Better to be in front of me than behind the computer. So, the first, this is very full of meaning. Just because there are 3-4 lines, we cannot gloss over them. That's why we have taken so long to understand what is the Swarupa, means the nature of the I unfolded in this portion of what is called the Great Forest Upanishad. Means huge. Aranya is what? Forest. And the forest is famous for people getting lost. No other reason, Forest is famous for a number of things. One is first, we don't have that much because of that many forests anymore because of deforestation, which is sad because we can't even illustrate what the forest means, without a little bit of wistful thinking about all this timber logging and all these things. Now, forest is famous for getting lost because it's like a maze. Because once you are among the trees, you can't see the forest. There's the saying also, you can't see the forest for the trees. Meaning you're looking at the trees and you get caught up in the tree. And then what? You don't have a sense of bearing because pretty soon, it's easy to get lost in an airport parking lot. It all seems the same, correct? What to talk of a forest? It all seems the same. You go round and round and round. And so the forest is akin to samsara. Definitely. There is this kind of a forest, samsaric quality in the forest in the sense that you can get lost. Correct? But this is not a samsaric forest, this is a different kind of a forest. It's a forest of knowledge. Great forest of knowledge. Brihat. Brihat Aranya, great, huge forest of knowledge. Nonetheless, it is easy to get lost. Right? Because you don't know where to go, you don't know what to read, you don't know what to read first, you don't know what to read next. And so it's a great forest. And then the forest also is an ecosystem in and of itself. It is a complete system. Each thing, you know, builds upon the other. Each thing is alive because of the other and all these things. So likewise, the Brihadaranyaka is a series of chapters. And in the beginning, we have the teaching. Teaching of what? How to make cookies. Teaching of what? Teaching of Brahmavidya, self-knowledge. Yeah. And in this, first the teaching is given through chapters like this Madhuvidya, and another chapter we have already studied is Atmava Are Drashtavyah Shrutavyah Mantavyah Nididhyasitavyah. You know? So the famous Yajnavalkya Maitreyi dialogue. So this is there. And there are certain other, teaching situations. Famous one, another one involving Gargi. Gargi is testing, Sage Yajnavalkya to see whether she's been appointed to test, because she's also known as Brahmavadini, meaning the one who only talks about Brahman, or the one who knows Brahman, or the one who is immersed in Brahman. And so she's qualified to test. And she keeps asking question after question after question, ticks off Sage Yajnavalkya, who says, if you ask any more questions, may your head roll off your shoulders. And when I came across that, I thought, this is such an insulting thing. I mean, he's after all a candidate. He should not talk like that to the interviewer. This is coming from a modern mind. But when I checked with Pujya Swamiji said that it was, He said it was a banter among equals. Yeah, it was just literally a curse, may your head fall off, roll off your shoulders. It was a kind of a banter. It was more like, you know, come on, stop quizzing me. It was more like a slang. Stop giving me a hard time. You know, what are you doing? It was like that. And so, like this, you know, so in the beginning we have all the teaching, the first 4-5 chapters. Then the rest of the chapters are, what is that? The upasanas. What is upasana?
Meditation.
You know, a kind of a, not just meditation, meditational sadhanas, practices. So many practices, starting from chanting of mantras to visualization. So many things you visualize in your mind and it tells you what to visualize. Visualize this, visualize a bird, visualize this, like this Taittiriya Upanishad says. So in Brihadaranyaka there are certain meditations, and it also has towards the end, if there are certain desires still lurking in the heart because of which you cannot get into this knowledge, there is a way to take care of those desires also. And the recipe for those desires are already given there, even though it's Upanishad. Because this is usually the first portion of the Veda that deals with all these kinds of things. But here, the Upanishad, you know, herself says, after all this knowledge, if you still want, if somebody now desires what? You know, duhitame pandita syat. I want a very scholarly daughter, very extremely erudite and scholarly daughter. Then it gives a recipe. What is the recipe? Unfortunately, we don't know how to make the recipe. But it says, mix til and rice. Tilaudhanam pachayitva ishniyatam. You know, may one eat til rice. Yeah, so if you eat til rice, and if you are desiring to have a very erudite and scholarly daughter, then what? Then your wish will be granted if you do it prayerfully, how it is to be done, etc., etc. So like this, the one would say that's why it's called a forest, because all kinds of things are there. Even the little pieces of Karmakanda comes in. Here, this is not supposed to be in the Upanishad. Upanishad is called knowledge portion. It should deal only with self-knowledge. Aye, please sit. It should deal only with self-knowledge. But here, this is given purposely for two reasons. One, it is to address the leftover desires that is stopping one from abiding in the knowledge. You know, I know I am Brahman, but I don't have a scholarly daughter. Supposing somebody has that leftover desire, then let it be fulfilled. That is the idea. And that's why it's a forest, because it has all kinds of things and very interesting anecdotes. And it's also a forest because the primary reason it's a forest is without a guide, one gets lost. And who is the guide? Upanishad herself in the form of the teacher is the guide. And the teacher who taught the Upanishad to the student, who has then become the teacher, is a guide. Not this apne aap knowledge. Apne aap knowledge means what? I sat under a tree and something fell. Yeah. You know, and then suddenly I was enlightened. And what's the enlightenment? Don't sit under trees. That is the enlightenment. So, this spontaneous coming of knowledge, really speaking, these days, you know, we don't accept. Because we know that the parampara is how the knowledge is gained. And if somebody comes in the face of it and says, I got this knowledge all by myself, then one of two things only could have happened. One is they had had so much preparation and they had studied everything in the last life, but because of, you know, what? The desire to be born in America, but they didn't have it last time. That's why they got a lifetime here. And then this knowledge was waiting to fructify, and then suddenly under the right circumstances, it fructified because it was already, the samskaras were there. But still, even for that activation, the guru is needed. The presence of the guru, you say, is needed. But some people don't need a lot of time. You see the guru and immediately you feel you know everything. And then, you know, that is one explanation. The other explanation is that, you know, it is just a feeling that one knows, or one kind of, like when you sit with a Mahatma, you have a sense of well-being and peace. And that sense of well-being and peace does not belong, it is not the copyright of the Mahatma. It is actually your own well-being and peace, which is impossible to recognize in the din and the noise of the everyday. It's impossible to recognize. Therefore, what the Mahatma's, you know, what is the thing? The Mahatma's company does, the only thing that the Mahatma's company does, it reminds you, because the self is one. And the self that the Mahatma is exuding and manifesting is the same as your own self, which you are right now having trouble manifesting in that same manner. So the Mahatma's company reminds you of that, and it's easy to get there. That's all it is, you know, really. And so, that, you know, so therefore, this knowledge comes from a parampara, it is shown, with the help of each of these akhyayikas, each of these, chapters have a, katha, a story. The story performs many, many functions. The story kind of lulls the doubting mind. And says, oh, here are Devata, Indra is going to get knowledge, correct? This is not some, you know, roadside Rama or roadside Romeo going for the knowledge. It is Indra, who is the lord of all the lords. Indra is getting knowledge. So definitely this, if Indra is going for this, leaving everything, the comfort of his heaven, etc., that means this is worth pursuing. That's one thing, you know. One thing we get out of the thing, we start to sit up and take this seriously. And if Indra can get it, I can also get it. And then second is, you know, there are so many doubts and fears connected to self-knowledge. And when you, usually when we illustrate it through a story, and you know, the story doesn't say you are having the doubts. In the story, a character is having the doubts. Then you feel safe enough to just listen and assimilate the teaching, built with certain stories. And here the story is rather extreme because we have an angry student, you know, of Vedanta, which is what? An oxymoron, really. Because you have to study Vedanta, one is told to give up anger. Correct? Kama, krodha, lobha, moha, mada, matsarya, the six difficulties, and you know, which are embodied in the six faces of Shanmukha. And you know, each one you know, shows a master of these difficult emotions. You know, unbridled desires, anger, no? Greed, avarice, delusion, pride, and jealousy, envy. So these are very, you know, they are very difficult to overcome, and they are extremely human emotions in the sense that everybody has them. So lest anyone think, I am always angry, I can't get the knowledge, they will be very encouraged by this story. The story of Indra going to the Dhyan, his Maharshi. And not only did he gain the knowledge, he put a lock on the Guruji's mouth and said, if you teach this to anybody else, he had not just anger but jealousy also. Nobody else should get this. This is all mine. Nobody else should. If you teach this to anybody else, what will happen? Remember the story? Yeah. Off with, I will myself come. If not, that the head will fall off. I will myself come and decapitate you. Poor Guru went into meditation. He stopped all the classes. He wrote a board, ashram closed. Yeah. No more teaching. Teaching is not going to go on. Why? Because there is a sword of Indra, Vajra, dangling on the head. You know? So he closed the ashram, and then some, you know, this pair of twins sauntered in and said, please give us this knowledge. He said, forget it, didn't you see the sign outside? Ashram closed, no more is the teaching going to happen, because you know this is the story. That's why I'm keeping quiet. Not that he was scared or whatever, this is just to, you know, invoke the human interest part. It was not that he was scared, whether he taught or not made no difference. But since they asked, he said, look, my prarabdha is not over, and I don't want to make it over right now and take another birth. So therefore, let's just chill. Let's not ask for this knowledge. And they were doctors. They were, you know, they were plastic surgeons. They were doctors. They had shalya chikitsa. They had knowledge of surgery. And they went and said, we will do a consult and get back. So when they went to their room, they saw, thought about this and came up with an ingenious plan. What was the plan? Yeah. So, let before he cuts off the head, he will only cut off your head. And Rishi Dadhyam said, thanks a lot. No, wait, we are not yet done. He will cut off the head, and then we have a nice chest, we will keep it ready for retransplantation at a later date. So, and then the teacher is ahead. You know, basic things we need, you know, to teach, you need a head. And so he said, how will I teach? Headless teacher. And he said, no, we will get you a horse's head, and you teach through the horse's head. And then Indra, because he has a lot of powers, what will he do? He will come to know that you are teaching. And being angry, he will not even look, he will cut off what? The horse's head. At which point we will have our general anesthesia, sutures, everything ready. And we have the ice chest ready. And then we transplant your own head back onto you. Even if you don't get Brahma Vidya out of this, the thing you can get out of this is to know that Prarabdha is inevitable. Even if you are Rishi Dadhyan, Dadhichi, also known as Dadhichi. So some student has to cut, angry, jealous student or the helpless doctor, helpful doctor student, doesn't matter. This is the Prarabdha. And so this is how, so now what we are getting is very authentic knowledge because it is coming through the horse's mouth. This is, yeah, not to be toyed around. This has to be taken seriously. This is knowledge right out of the horse's mouth. I suppose that's how this expression came. You know, everything has come from the Vedas. Or at least I like to tell myself. And then, so this is Rishi Dadhyan teaching through the horse's mouth. In fact, this horse's mouth has an abiding presence. Even in the Shakta worship, we have this teacher called Hayagriva. Haya means horse, Griva, neck. The other one with the horse's face. He taught Agastya and Lopamudra. He taught. And he taught, what is that? Dalita Trishati. He taught. Hayagriva. So same, you know, same kind of a principle here. Hayagriva is of course a later, because it is in the Puranas, that is later. This is the, from here only, this is the blueprint for Hayagriva. And so now we are getting the knowledge from the horse's mouth. And the one, the verse, the mantra that we just chanted, talks about the nature of the Atma. Atma means what? Yeah, why it's taking so long?
It's
self. Don't say self. I. Oh, Atma means I. Aham. Atma is I. And so this is, you know, the nature of the Atma. What is the nature of the Atma? And so if the question is asked to a general person, what is the nature of the Atma? Well, I'm not feeling too good today. I'm hungry. That is the nature of the prana, not the atma. I'm sleepy. That is prana dharma. Prana dharma. I'm angry. That is mano dharma. Dharma here means attribute. That's the nature of the mind. That's mano dharma. I'm restless. You know? And then what? I'm thin, I'm fat, I'm tall, I'm short. What answer? A good day. Why? Because the mind is all wrong. That's why. That's why we have a saying, woke up from the wrong side of the bed. This is what it is. So, we are not looking at the nature of the Atma from these standpoints. Because the one who is noticing everything, all the afflictions, all the fears, all the pains, all the sorrow is unafflicted. This is the logic. The unafflicted one alone can perceive and cognize and witness the affliction. Even the status of Sakshi, Sakshitvam is what? Is mithya, is not to be, it's an incidental status when something is there to be witnessed. But really speaking, that witness is unafflicted. So when you say, I am restless, you mean to say the mind is restless. And if I am saying the mind is restless, who is the one noticing that the mind is restless? Mind cannot notice that the mind is restless. Why? Because the mind is, so there is someone else, a non-restless I that is noticing, cognizing, lamenting the presence, so to speak, of a restless mind. Lament also happens later. That is another one that is attached to the mind is lamenting why I am restless, why the mind is restless. But really, the mind is, you know, here. The mind is not observing itself. Something else is observing the body, the mind. Yeah, because the body doesn't care if it puts on weight. He doesn't notice also. Someone notices. And that I is different, is not the same as the body-mind-sense complex. It informs the body, it animates the mind, it animates the prana, the respirations, it animates the whole, you know, body-mind complex. But itself is not dependent upon the body. It's not dependent upon the mind, but the other way around is not true. Without the Atma, there is no body. Pun intended, no body, nothing. Without the Atma, there is nothing. No life, no animation, no existence. It is the source of all existence and it lends its satta, its presence and its spurti. Spurti means its animating power to all things in the universe. Itself doesn't need to have a different source of existence. Itself doesn't need to be powered by anything else. Because so if Atma is powered by something, then that is the Atma, correct? And so this is what is revealed in the first mantra. The Atma has certain it has a certain definition, and it has a two-part definition. The first definition is called Swarupa Lakshana. Lakshana means what? Definition. Swarupa means from the standpoint of an heart. So if I had to just talk about what doesn't change about the Atma, and here is what it is given, you know, it is says that, you know, this is Tejomayaha. It is all light, and light here is a metaphor for knowledge. It's all knowledge. It's all light means it's all knowledge. What do you mean I am full of knowledge? In fact, I thought I was ignorant. How can I be all knowledge? You are all knowledge because you know. Do you know you exist?
Yes.
Yes. Oh. Do you exist? First question.
Yes.
Yeah. Do you exist?
Yes.
Yeah. I was hoping somebody will say no, but nobody. Because if you say no, then that means what? You are proving your existence. It's like a child hiding behind the couch and saying, I'm not hiding behind the couch. That's how it is. Do you exist? Yes. Then the next question is, how do you know? Who told you you exist? You cannot say, my spouse told me I exist. Thankfully, this is one question you can answer without seeking the opinion or the permission of the spouse. Thank God. There should be a few questions like that. Without seeking the approval, the permission, or the, permission or some kind of a blessing of the significant other, I can clearly say, one can clearly say what? I am. I am means I exist. Are you here? Yes. How do you know? You know, you don't say, I'll find out and get back to you. No. Can you come tomorrow? Oh, I'll get back to you on that. But that's a different question. Can you be here at a certain time? Oh, I'll have to look at that and I'll have to look at my schedule and get back to you. Are you here? Nobody says, I'll have to look at my schedule and get back to you. Mary, sit here. It's better. Come. So, then we have, that is what is called knowledge. Why is that called knowledge? Because I know I am. How do you know you are? Who told you? You know? I just know. And this knowledge, it's always I know, I know, I know. I am, I know, I am, I know, I know, I am. Asti, 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 you know, iti, upalabhyate, kathopanishad. It always does, yes, is, am. And each time you say I am, that means what? I know I am. Because this no never becomes I don't know. Right? Even if one leaves the body, what does one say? I have left the body. I am in some other form. Preta. Prakarshena itaha pretaha. Itaha means gone. Correct? But you can go to the market and come back. But when you add pra in front of itaha, that means one is not coming back. That is what is called preta. So you can say, okay, now I had a body. One can say, now the body is not there, right? But still I know, I know, I know. And this I know never becomes I don't know. But how is that possible? Because I really don't know Greek. How do you know you don't know Greek? Huh? In that question is the answer. You say, I know, I don't know Greek. I'm the witness of my knowledge. I'm the witness of my ignorance. Yeah. And you can never say, you know, this I know never becomes I don't know. That's why Atma, Tejo Mayaha, which is all knowledge because it always shines. It is self-shining. First thing, it is self-shining. That's why it is all light. I don't have to seek somebody's permission to find out whether I am. I know because it is self-luminous. Self-evident to me, I am evident to me, everything is evident to me, therefore what? I am. How do you know? I know I am. Tejo mayaha, amrita mayaha. Amrita mayaha means this I is not subject to death. This should be a great relief. You know, what dies, whatever dies, let anything die, what dies is not the I. I doesn't die. No, but then I have to give up this body. Good thing is, before one gives up the body itself has given up on one. Then it's easy. Then you say, okay, I don't want this body. Time for a new one. Vasamsi jirnani yatha vihaya. Narani grinhati aparani. So, like that. So, all of this. Very wonderful because this is amritamayaha, meaning it is all not at all. The I is the not one thing we know. The I is forever. And if the I is ignorant of itself, if one is ignorant of the nature of the I, then even then one is not subject to death. One takes on many, many bodies. That's all it is until this knowledge comes. If one is, you know, ignorant of oneself. If one is not ignorant of oneself and then one gives up the body, so it is what is called videha mukti, because one was already Bhagavan, venerated as Bhagavan in the body, and then the subtle body joins the subtle elements, the gross body joins the gross elements. There is no karana sharira or causal body, and therefore what happens? There is no reason to come back. That's all. Come back means you are as I, in you know, you have joined everything. You are one with everything. You are already one with everything. And so this is what has to be seen. So tejo mayaha, all knowledge, amrita mayaha. In these two, you know, in these two words, the whole thing is given. Purushaha, you know, purushaha means sarva purayati, that which exists in and as everything. So this I, you know, is there without undergoing any change, is there in everything, as everything, every source of existence, not separate from this I. Everything that is animate, inanimate, is nothing but an extension of this I. So the whole world is just Brahman consciousness. And this consciousness happens to be all knowledge and all existent, the only source of existence, and I am eva saha, I am atma idam amritam. And then it is the only source of existence, and it is forever. This is the new autobiography of a yogi. Yeah. Who are the yogis? All of you listening to your own life story. This is the Nimya. This is a refurbished autobiography of a yogi, because that is what the Upanishad is. The Upanishad is the autobiography of myself, which is very pleasant to hear. Because every day, you know, what is it that I'm hearing? You are no good, I'm an idiot, I'm not whatever. And even if nobody says that, I say that to myself. I'm a loser. Why are you calling yourself a loser? Because usually by this time, three people would have called me a loser. Nobody has done that, so I have to do it myself. Because it is so deeply internalized. And so here, nobody is saying anything. And here, it's a very pleasant, you know, pleasant, nice sounding. You are Tejo Mayaha. Wow. All light, all knowledge. Even though I'm not enlightened, I'm all light, yes. And I know I'm all knowledge, yes. Because you can say on Sarvam. All. What is all? What all I know plus what all I don't know is equal to all, correct? Do you know what you know?
Yes.
Do you know what you don't know?
Yes.
Yes. Then that means you are all knowing. And it sounds so wonderful to hear all this. Ah, wow. Because otherwise it's a sob story, you know. It's a jivik, you were. Jivik sob story of a that I don't feel good. Front ache, back ache, side ache, headache. Even if one doesn't have a headache, one is a headache to others. You know, either way, headache applies. Something or the other. So how are the aches and pains? No, aches and pains are all right. Now today they are not there. Oh, yippee! No, but I'm in a bad mood. So this is the autobiography one writes about oneself. I am a failure. I'm a loser. I haven't done this. I haven't done that. Bucket list, you know. This is only in America. Yeah, Indians don't need to make bucket list. Yeah. Because we have Buddhists also. Because we have reincarnation. Yeah, we have plenty of time. Ek life mein list nahi banayenge. What a waste of time. So, people say this openly. In this life, not possible. Next, better luck next time. We say this to each other. You know, and when somebody passes away, you know, they will say, you know, especially if, you know, this happened. I saw this one person passed away. He had two sons. One of them was a Swami. One of them is a Swami in our order. And the other one was a kind of, the other son was kind of a, what is that called?
Bogi.
Yeah, not a yogi, bogi, but not even a bogi, he was like a hobo, you know, like a, just going from here, there, yeah, no future, no prospects, nothing, he was just kind of a straggler, you know, and naturally the father was disappointed in his life, and then at the, you know, funeral, they said a benediction, you know, from the Brihadaranyaka, which deals with the children and everything. They basically wished him off, you know, he had led a full life, he was old, but there was one thing rankling, that's not even one child, you know, because the sadhu means he should have been proud of the sadhu son. It's very hard, it's very wonderful to appreciate the sadhu coming from the neighborhood, or from the next door, or from somebody else's house. And then you can be very proud of, oh, I knew this fellow when he was a child. And oh, he sat on my lap. You know, and he is so wonderful. You know, you can say all that. You can appreciate the sadhu, but in the Indian psyche, when your own son becomes a sadhu, it is very asadhu. Yeah, people act as though it's a huge mourning. Yeah, they pull a long face and they, you know, and they act out, enact the drama of abandonment, you know. And even though the sadhu will be visiting, but still, that drama of enact the abandonment is deeply internalized and expressed and aired out to everybody that visits, you know. This is what the thing is. So this man had some regrets about his offspring, progeny wise. He had always felt he was not lucky because, you know, one had taken to the Himalayas and the other one, you know, had no alaya. So then, no nilaya. And then, alaya means any abode to call his own, you know. And so then they said a very beautiful benediction that may you have the kind of santati that you desired in your next life. May your children be obedient, because clearly the sadhu, you know, sadhu and obedience don't go together. And, you know, because the sadhu obeys another order. You know, the sadhu doesn't obey human beings. And so, therefore, and sadhu does certainly is not going to obey the father. Okay? So, this is the whole thing. And then the other one, of course, no obedience there. But here they said a very nice benediction for the departed soul that in the next life, may you have very good progeny, somebody that, you know, somebody who is after your heart, somebody who gives you comfort during old age, somebody who is there only for you and doesn't do all these things, and, you know, and like this. So Indians don't make bucket list because it's a waste of time. Yeah. What's the use? You know, because next life is there, after that another life, I can have as many as I want. Based on my desires, so many lives are there. Correct? But even then, the I doesn't come to an end. Even if you don't know the nature of the I, it doesn't come to an end. So even a person off the street who doesn't even know V for Vedanta, you know, is what? Is in the Hindu Dharma, is very happy and very, you know, comfortable to know next life something better may come. So this is a cushion, it's not fatalism. It's a cushion towards, you know, seeing that, you know, there is, that all these things, you know, that life does not come to an end. Nothing comes to an end. It's just a transformation. And so here, from the standpoint of the knowledge also, the I is infinite, immortal, and all knowledge. That is the only self-definition. That's why every sadhu's name ends in Ananda. Yes. Ananda. And you know, I think I told you the story. And I got a phone that there is a Swami coming. I don't know what to do, this lady said. I don't know what to do, this Swami is coming. Can you please tell me how to welcome the Swami? I said, sure. And then I was curious because I didn't know who it was. I thought maybe I will know this person. Who is he? What's his name? His name is Sadananda. Sadananda. You know, American pronunciation. Sadananda became Sadananda. You know, Sad is opposite of Ananda. But so then I said, no, it's not Sadananda. And I was trying to tell her the correct pronunciation. She said, no, I have it written down. He told me his name. It is Sadananda. I said, no, it's not Sadananda. It is what? Sadananda. Sada means always. Correct? So, that is my nature. My nature is not Sadananda. It is Sadananda. Because, but what if I am crying? Even if you are crying, what is holding up the tears is Ananda. That's how, even though one is upset, crying, one pulls on. Crying, you make coffee. Crying, you heartily abuse the situation that has brought you to the tears. Crying, crying, you make plans for revenge, sweet revenge. Crying, crying, you go about, how? Oh, because that ananda is what is the canvas, so to speak, on which a tear is embroidered. That's all it is. All the tears are just embroidered on this tapestry, which is free of all attributes, which is called Brahman, and the word Brahman comes at the end of the last time. We have already gone through this, but this is just a, what is that? Cliff notes. Quick connection to the next one. That's basically the things. And so, this is what is called Swarupa definition, Swarupa Lakshana, the definition of the I from the standpoint of what? No, Atma we know. From the standpoint of the unchanging definition. That is what is Swarupa, because it is unchanging. Then, it's not enough to define the Brahman, I, that source, the only source of knowledge, existence, consciousness, that consciousness, that sentient consciousness. It is which pervades in and everything, through everything. It's not just enough to define it from that standpoint, because there is not just an unchanging aspect, there is also a changing aspect. And what is the changing aspect? Everything, the whole jagat. Changing. Now like this, now not like this. 1 minute it's different. Even as we sit here, you know, compared to when we sat in this room, we are all so many minutes older. Yeah. And like this, so many changes are there. Micro level changes, macro changes, small changes, big changes. And, you know, in and through the changes, that which doesn't change, we have determined is up. But what about the things that change? Do they change randomly? Are they molecules that just somehow, some people believe this, that the body, for example, is a bunch of molecules that randomly became kidneys and randomly became brain, you know, and then randomly became liver. And, you know, so this, is it really random? And if it is random, then there should be nothing I can predict, correct? If everything is randomly assembled, then there should be no laws. Simple. But there are universal laws that the physicists themselves have discovered, without which there is no physics. Any kind of physics. In fact, we can't walk from here to that door. Why? Because we don't know whether there is gravity, where is gravity, how much gravity is there, will it hold me up? We don't know anything. We keep missing. But because gravity is unchanging, we are able to rely on that and build our homes, correct? Yeah. You can be a homeowner only because of gravity, no other things. Because of gravity, you can buy a house. It will not lie away. It will remain there. It will not just suddenly tip to its side. It will not suddenly go away somewhere. And even if it does, there is a law behind that. And there is a law connected to the seasons. It's not random. There is a law connected to the, you know, the trees turning yellow, red, brown. There is a law to ice, snow. There is a law to the rain, when and how and how much or how much not. Even if it's a deluge, even if there is a disorder, it is part of the manifestation of the order. The disorder is included in this order, an order that transcends disorder. This is what we are talking about. So there is an order. If there is an order, who is in charge? That is the question. What is the answer? I, yeah, how can I be in charge? What are you talking about? You know, the only thing I know how to make is confusion. I don't know how to create anything else. What do you mean I am in charge of sriti, sthiti, laya, samhara? How can I be in charge of creation, dissolution, maintenance of all this? I can't be in charge. You know, again, you have to look at what I we are, what is the definition of this I? The I as the Purusha, this Brahman, which is here presented as Bhagavan, a conscious entity, limitless conscious entity, endowed with not just all knowledge, but all power, all Shakti, is in charge. And that is what is described in the second mantra here, which we will look at. Sava ayam atma.
Sarvesham
adhipati.
Sarvesham
bhutanagam. Raja. Tadyatha. Radhanabhauja. Radhanimauja. Araha. Sarve samarpita.
Sarve samarpita.
Evameva.
Evameva.
Asmin atmani.
Asmin atmani.
Sarvani bhutani.
Sarvani bhutani.
Sarve devaha.
Sarve devaha.
Sarve lokaha.
Sarve lokaha.
Sarve pranaha.
Sarve pranaha.
Sarva ete.
Sarva ete.
Atmanaha. Atmanaha.
Atmanaha.
Samarpita.
Samarpita.
Yeah, so this is, this is what is called Tatastha Lakshana. And we have illustrated this using the example. What is the example?
Crow.
Ah, very good. Crow sitting on the friend's house, especially in Atlanta. Yeah, because of where all the houses here, especially in the suburbs, look exactly alike. Exactly like another one. Yeah. And today, I was going to somebody's house and the person driving me said, do you recognize this? I said, they all look the same. I recognize this one looking exactly like the other one. Oh. So supposing you find out that your friend has moved to somebody's house, some new house in a new development, but you don't know which one. You drive there and you want to greet them. And then you say, what? So you find out from somebody, did the new Indian family move? And yeah, they came this morning, I saw the truck. Where? Which is the house? Over there, that one. Which one? They all look alike. The person is also, the one who is giving direction is also a little puzzled. They say, oh, wait a minute. You see the house with a crow on it? You know, real crow, not some kind of what is that called?
Scarecrow.
Not scarecrow, the windmill. Not windmill.
Weather vane.
Not the one, there also they have some crows going like that. That's not the one. The real crow sitting on it. Do you see that? House with a crow on it? Yes. That's, I think, your friend's house. Then you go, you're very happy to see your friend. Next week they invite you for a housewarming. Then you are there looking for the crow, correct?
No.
No. Why?
We no longer need it.
You don't need the crow. Why? Because the crow has done its job and flown away. And similarly, that is what is called Tatastha Lakshana. So this, talking about the jagat. We are not interested in talking about the crow, correct? What are we interested in? The friend's house. We are interested in locating the friend's house, not to write a dissertation upon the crow, right? Yeah. So here, similarly, we are not interested in the jagat. Oh, jagat means this whole universe, manifest universe. Oh, but you may not be interested in the manifest universe, but I am deeply enchanted by the manifest universe. Yeah, that's why you are coming here. Come more frequently, and you will also be, you know, you will also see that you are not that interested in the manifest universe. The manifest universe, we are not interested in. The manifest universe, we are only interested in to recognize Brahman, the nature of the I, from another standpoint, from the standpoint of being non-separate, from being that consciousness which is non-separate from that, the one who is the manifester. Got it? Say yes, so we can move on. You want me to repeat it? No? Yes. Ah. So, we are not interested in the manifest universe, no matter how enchanting the Jagat may be. We are interested in recognizing the I as non-separate from the one who is the creator, the maintainer, and the resolver, and unto whom the manifest universe resolves. I am interested in defining myself in nature to the universe. Who is this I in nature to the manifest universe? I am the one who has created this. I am the one who is manifesting this. I am the one unto whom everything resolves. And this is very easy to see in the dream. What happens in the dream? No, not the dream that comes in the Vedanta class. Yeah, so when you in the, what happens in the dream? Let's say you're dreaming of four or five people and you went to a nice restaurant. Why? Obviously it was your birthday, so you wanted to celebrate your birthday. So you went out to have a nice lunch or dinner. You went out to have a nice meal at a restaurant. In the dream, who is you? You have given yourself a body. Yes? No?
Yes.
Yeah. And then who are the friends? Are they really there?
No.
They are also who? You. Your own memory of those friends, your own awareness, your own memory, your own knowledge of those friends, your own desire to see the friends, you give your own consciousness, your own awareness gives the four or five friends their bodies, right? And then let's say one of them brings a dog. Who is the dog? You. And then let's say there are tables and chairs in a restaurant. What about all the inanimate things in the dream? First you have the car, then you have the road, then you have all the scenery on the either side, and then you have some non-moving things like trees, etc. Then you have moving things, cars. You have animate things, living things, insentient things like rug, table, chair, tablecloth, fork, spoon. Who is all of this? Who created?
You.
Out of what did you create? You went and stole the table linen from the restaurant in the night?
No.
You created it out of your own memory, your own knowledge and your own desire, correct? And you manifested this table, manifested the tablecloth, manifested water glasses, forks, spoons, knives, everything, and manifested a nice, very efficient looking waiter, waitress, whoever it is who comes and says, what will you have today? And what about the food? Who is the food?
You.
Who created the food?
You.
Who? Whose awareness is sustaining the food?
You.
It's all you. And then what happens?
Huh?
Yeah, alarm rings. Yeah. Unfortunately. And then you wake up. Are you sitting at the table with a half finished bowl of food and four friends?
No.
The friends are not sitting with you on the bed, correct? And then the bed is not littered with what? Today we in the morning we learnt a new word. What is that? Kulunchas. It sounds like kulchas. The bed is not having kulchas and you know, food there. Where did it all go? First of all, where did it all come from? Yeah, where did the dream come from? Your own memory, your own desire. After giving the answer, you should be able to give it back. So your own, remember this, this is very important. Your own memory, your own desire creates your dream universe, sustains your dream universe. And into your own memory, into your own awareness, that whole universe resolves when it is time to wake up. So you are also Sarvatma here. You are also Bhagavan of your dream. You are the creator, the sustainer, and the resolver of your own dream. Correct? Mm-hmm. You are that. And then we just have to extrapolate this example into the whole universe. So kamayati tahusram praja gegeti satapo tapyati. This is what is called the creation. Story in the Taittiriya Upanishad. Saha, this being who is endowed with all knowledge, all shakti to create, to resolve, to maintain, akamayat, had a desire. Before you went to sleep, you also had a desire. May I be loved and may my friends, may I have a nice dinner with my friends. Maybe the desire was deep inside the subconscious mind, but it was a desire nonetheless. Here too, Bhagavan, so to speak, had a desire. What is the difference between one's desire and Bhagavan's desire? Bhagavan's desire doesn't have any pressure behind it. The individual's desire is full of pressure. Full of pressures to fulfill. In fact, you know, we say, only when put to a corner, why is there a universe? If somebody, you know, keeps on asking me, I will say, it is to wear out one's karmas. And it is to wear out one's, exhaust one's karmas. And then, because of one's karmas, alone the universe is created. So in fact, Bhagavan's desire, even though it says, saha akamayat, he desired, here, the great being desired, it's not that he desired. It's our own desires as jivas that are clamoring for fructification and want a universe to play around in. So the desires of the jiva become a goad, you know, that goads Bhagavan, come on, create, create, create. Manifest this because I am unmanifest and you can't fulfill your desire when one is unmanifest, correct? Yeah, because how can you? You can't smell, you can't see, you can't eat, you're just there. So therefore, I need a body, and the body can't be just hanging around in the universe. And so I need a place to put this body and all kinds of sense objects to enjoy. That is how this whole being comes. So it is not Bhagavan's desire, it's the desire of jivas to reenact the previous kalpa of creation and to find a place where they can get all their, you know, wrinkles of desires out. This is what we, you know, yes, this is what the whole thing is. If pressed to a corner, we will say that. But really speaking, one must not go there as a Vedanta student because, you know, I said that otherwise we are, you know, counting the feathers of the crow the more we discuss the Jagat. And we are not writing a dissertation of the crow. It is, what are we interested in? We are interested in the house, not the crow. So similarly, if the Jagat, you know, is symbolized by the crow, then what is the house? The house is my abode, myself. That house is Brahman. That is what we are interested in. But since the crow has come, it points to the house. And similarly, the Jagat gives a certain, a status to Brahman, where Brahman is now known as Bhagavan, as the creator, resolver, as the one with all power, or Bhagavati, the one with all power, all knowledge, the one with the power to retract, project, sustain everything. Very beautiful. And so, this is what is described here, this is what is called Swarupa, Tathastha Lakshana. So, let us look at it. We have seen some of it, but we haven't seen all of it. So, Saha Vai Ayam Atma Sarvesham Adhipati Adhipatihi. Sarvesham Adhipatihi means the overlord, Adhipatihi, overlord of Sarvesham. And that is described again, and that is unfolded again. Sarvesham Bhutanam Raja. This we can understand. Adhipatihi is a difficult word. What is overlord? Or what is overruler? You know? Raja, like even a king. Rajate shines, presides over. The ultimate authority, really, of all jivas who will get born in which lineage, in which parentage, what is the karmas, lift trap all the karmas and make them timed release. Correct? Yeah, you will not get released fast. It will release only at a particular time, in that particular way, in that particular manner. And sometimes the karmas are ghora karmas, correct? Yeah, very difficult karmas. And so even if one is a dharmic person, sometimes one gets into trouble. Because this is not from this life. This life one is a dharmic person, last life what happens one doesn't know. That is how even in India, Shankaracharya ended up in Karavasa, in jail, few years back. So like this, you don't know what is there. Some ghora karmas might be lying in store. But because of one's prayerfulness, they have a little cushion. The prayer gives a little soft landing into these karmas. So this is the Raja. And the jiva's karmic, the law of all, karma, unto which the jivas are subject. So from that standpoint, the jiva is praja. Praja and raja from the standpoint of the ignorant one. As long, that's why I say, don't get caught up in the jagat, in discussing the jagat. Why does it originate? How does it originate? Who am I? Because then one may be completely caught up in it. And the whole point is not to write a thesis on karma, but to transcend the notion, I am a karta. I am the doer. That notion one has to transcend. And that's why one is looking at it from this angle. Because here, as long as I'm connected to the doership, then there is a whole lot of karmas standing in my account. Three bank accounts. One is, checking account. Prarabdha karma, correct? And then prarabdha karma, checking account, you keep spending. And then when it is zero, then bye-bye. One departs the body. And then what? Then you have an account that is empty at birth, but it keeps getting filled up. You have a what is that where the monthly pay goes? That kind of an account. Yeah, not even cumulative, but something it's got a name. Not savings account, not fixed deposit. Yeah, a direct deposit special account. So whatever you do in 1 month, comes at the end of the month, you get that. That is called agami karma. But you can't withdraw from that. Here. Then you have your fixed deposit, sanchita. Everything is there. Papa, punya, everything. Then somebody said, until you exhaust all your karma, you will not get moksha. Be prepared to get depressed because you never exhaust all the karma. The thought itself is exhausting. That's all it is. You will get exhausted. You cannot exhaust all the karma. Right? Because how many karmas are there? 1, 2, 3, infinite number of karmas. You thought only Brahman is infinite. Karma closely competes with Brahman in this manner. In this regard, it is infinite number of lifetimes, infinite number of karmas. And so really, you can't exhaust all the results of action from so many lifetimes. You can only get exhausted. Therefore, the plan, you know, that you know, the plan A is bad. So plan B for Brahman, you know, should be what? Should be to get rid of the notion, I am the doer. If you get rid of the notion, if you grow out of the notion through the cognition that I am not the doer, I am not the recipient of action, I am not the author or the agent of action. And that is wonderful. And that is what Vedanta is. Akarta, abhokta. It's like a dead person's bank account. Where will the money go? No? Whether it is plus or minus, credit or debit, it doesn't matter, right? No. This is what we have to see. This is what we have to understand. We grow out of this whole karma business by understanding what? The nature of this I is Sarvesham Bhutanam Raja. That I am non-separate from that which is known, that consciousness which has the garb just now of being the creator of the universe. It's just a cloak. That's all it is. And so, through this understanding, and who is this I? What I thought before? Before I thought I was a sad beggar sitting at the table of life begging for some crumbs. Oh, give me this, give me that, give me this. But I forgot that this I, you know, I took my robes seriously. It's like a person who is playing an actor who is playing the role of a begging person in a play. And then got attached to the role, so to speak. And even though he was, let's say, this is a hypothetical situation, even though he was a highly paid actor, started to cry. And first the director was happy because without glittering he's crying and he's giving a realistic note to this role, but then he won't stop crying. Why? Because, oh my God, my life is ruined, look at my rags. Started to believe in the rags. The rags is just a role. And the one who has riches is also just a role. The role cannot roll into the person. The person is the role, but the role is not the person. Your role and the person are separate. The person is Purusha, Sarva Purayati. So the person doesn't get attached or completely identified with the role. That is the source of Kartritvam. That is the source of doership and misery. First, that's the source of misery, and because I want to get out of misery, I start doing more and more and more, and then what happens? More misery only comes. Because whatever I do, I don't like. Whatever comes out of the doing, also I don't like. And more miserable. So therefore, dropping the doership, that's why it is given in stages. First you say, I am not the doer. Who is the doer? Bhagavan is the doer. You drag in Bhagavan and put as a proxy doer. That's why the Shankaracharyas carry one stick. They put their own ahankara onto that stick. The stick becomes an actor. See, they cannot, they can never forget that they are not the actor. They are the actors. They can never forget that they are, you know, that. They won't get confused that they are the actors. So they put the ahankara onto the stick and keep the stick wherever the stick goes. But they are atma and this is ahankara. Ahankara is doing, I am just watching. This is how the whole thing is. Very beautiful it is. So through this understanding and through this knowledge, one overcomes this notion, I am the karta. So it is done in stages. First you say, I am not the doer. Who is the doer? Ishvara is the doer. Bhagavan is the doer. And then of course, then the primary question comes, if Bhagavan is the doer, why do I have karma phala? Why do I have the results of action? That's why we learn to take the results of action as what? Asada. Yeah, it's very beautiful. And because of that, you know, prasada here means glad acceptance. Forget glad, you can cross that out, strike through the word glad. And at least just keep acceptance there. Yeah. I want this, this is not happening. Okay. Alright. We try. Okay. Then that's also not happening. We try. Okay, then maybe it's not meant to be. Let's see something else. You know, like this, we have to get to a place of acceptance. Because when we are not in acceptance, there is anxiety and fear and sorrow. So the kartritvam is given up slowly like this. First Bhagavan is karta, and then through the unfoldment of this knowledge, through Madhuvidya, that which is like honey to hear, then because the nature of the I as Bhagavan is indeed like honey to hear, so I grow into the knowledge. What is that knowledge? That I am that Bhagavan. There is no Bhagavan that is separate from me. Because what is Bhagavan? You know, it's just like Raja and Praja. Or sometimes we say, Raja and what is that called? In the Panchadashi, there is a very nice example given. What is that called? The man at the door with the sentry. Yeah. So there is Raja, who is the king, correct? And the king has a uniform, big, nice, plush, velvet coat, gold embroidery, carrying one stick, a stick of what? You know, putting the underdog down, putting anybody down, you have to just look at the stick. Even the stick is never used, but if you look at the stick, one is intimidated. Then sometimes they have, in the Western kings, they carry something else, some scepter or something like that, some round, yeah. I have the whole world in my hands, literally. You know, they show that. So these are all the accoutrements of the king, correct? And then what? Then we have the accoutrements of the sentry. In Buckingham Palace, you know, it's like a big bumblebee hat. And then there is all this, you know, livery. Livery means uniform will be there. And then, you know, Panchadashi says, give them a sleeping drug. You know, put them to sleep, both of them. And then interchange their costumes. Now what? One who is the sentry is wearing the velvet coat and having the stick, having the crown, and is made to, you know, brought and made to sit on the throne like this, still sleeping. And the Raja is thrown out along with that little, you know, what is that called, spear, and wearing the livery. And when they wake up, God, they're one and the same really. That's how it is. The same thing with Jiva and Ishvara. We get intimidated by the dress and we're not ready to own up. So we get intimidated by Ishvara's dress and then one gets, you know, attached to one's rags. Two problems. I'm not ready to accept that and see that. And you know, in order to try on new clothes, you have to get rid of these. These also I cannot get rid of. This is the problem. And that's why here it says Raja, because that Raja image of the king gives, you know, gives this whole thing, you know, very beautifully. It describes the whole thing. And then, Sarvesham Bhutana, all elements, all elementals, everything is the Raja. And then what? That yatha gives an example. Yatha, in which way, rathanabhau cha rathanemau cha araha sarve samarpitaha. Rathanabhau is the hub, rathanabhi, nabhi, hub. Okay? So there is the hub, correct? And then there is what is called Feli. Feli means Nehi. You know the, what is that? So hub, you know. You know, and then there is that
rim.
Yes, the rim. Araha means the spokes. So the spokes radiate from the rim. Radiate from the hub and connect to the rim. So both ways they are connected. Just like that, you know, the whole universe is orchestrated by the laws which are in the hands of Bhagavan. You know, this is very, very important, very beautiful imagery. You know, Araha means spokes. Sarve samarpita. You know, so just like in that circumference, the whole thing, the whole wheel moves because of the rim, you can say. But really speaking, the rim is not so important. Why? Because the hub is the one that is controlling. So you can take the rim as the jiva and all the actions. So the rim is thinking, you know, I am the one, I am the actor. The hub is keeping quiet and not doing anything. But in fact, it is holding on to all the spokes, you know, which radiate from it. All the spokes here are the shaktis, various shaktis, very beautiful. All the powers, ichha shakti, jnana shakti, kriya shakti, you know. Varagi, Vaishnavi, Shambhavi, all these various shaktis which are there, the powers of the mothers are the spokes that make the rim move. Right? But ultimately, the Rathanabhi, the hub, without controlling anything, is orchestrating the whole show. This is Atma from the standpoint of Ishvara. So Ishvara is not acting, doesn't say I'm the actor, but without controlling anything, Ishvara is so kind and that he lets us think we are doing everything. But really speaking, everything, one is just a puppet under the hands of these circumstances and the exigencies, and this is very beautifully illustrated. Ratha, Ayurvinadha, Tadyatha, Rathanabhav, you know. And Rathanemao cha araha sarve samarpitaha. So just like samarpitaha means they are all, you know, they are all dedicated to the hub. They all ensue from the hub and then power the various elements within the wheel to make it function. Similarly, the jagat chakra, the wheel of life, the wheel of the universe is powered by Bhagavan, who is a force who is not acting, just in keeping with the laws of the universe. As though acting, you know. And then what? And then, you know, then evam eva, asmin atmani. Similarly, in the same manner, asmin atmani, in this atma, sarvani bhutani, you know, all the beings, sarve devaha, all the laws, devaha here means dyotanatmakatvat, Devaha, all the celestial laws in the form of Adhishthana Devatas, various, you know, functionaries, celestial functionaries in charge of what? Respiration, all these things, you know, and in charge of weather, five elements, what we call it, all these things. They are all there, you know, Sarvani Bhutani, Sarve Devaha, and Sarve Lokaha. We talked about Loka yesterday. How many? 14. Yeah. So, and if they find out one more, no problem. We can say, and whatever Lokas, how many ever they are, no problem. There is always room for more. And so Sarve Lokaha and Sarve Pranaha. How many pranas?
Five
pranas. And then Sarva Ete, you know, Samarpitaha, Atmani. So they are all in, everything goes back to the hub. This Atma, from the standpoint of Jagat Karanam Brahma, from the standpoint of being the cause of the universe, that causality is ascribed. Ascribed means it is incidental to the nature of Atma, just like the crow is incidental to recognizing the house. So this, what is that called? Causality, the status of being the cause is an incidental attribute of Atma. But it is important because we live in a what is called a manifest jagat. We live in a manifest jagat, and so it is important, and so that's why we are looking at it, because we are looking at the definition of Atma from the standpoint of the universe. And from the standpoint of the universe, the Atma is nothing but Jagat Karanam Brahma. It is imbued with the causality that is dispensable. Because why? The Jagat itself is dispensable. The universe is dispensable, correct? Yeah. Nobody is saying yes. Yeah. Because, the universe undergoes laya. And then, after some layas, pralaya. Yes. The universe itself goes into a state of demanifestation. And then again, when the jivas are clamoring for some, action, drama, then it comes. Lights, camera, action, the jiva says, Bhagavan says, okay, no problem. Here you go. Oh no, but I don't want to be born in India. Better luck next time. Everything starts. So that's what somebody asked, Why so many times Americans are so interested in Indian spirituality? How come? Because they have never been exposed to it. But so many people, they are so devout, they have so much shraddha, they have so much desire for this knowledge. And I say, because they were born in India last life. And they had a desire to be born in America, but the Indian spiritual samskara did not go. Did not go. And then same answer, we have to give a similar answer, and they say, why is this person born in India? He's always one foot in the West, doesn't want to do anything. Because only the last life was in America. So many things you can say. So like that, this show keeps going on and on and on, because because of the desires of the jiva propelling Bhagavan to create. But then the question comes, who is this Bhagavan? And then if I am confused, should I be a devotee? What? Bhagavan, how to do this? What to do? What is this? This is really confusing. That's why we have one more class tomorrow. Now, because we've had enough heavy stuff, now we can, we have a choice. We can either stop here, take some questions, have a nice evening, or I can do what I promised, is talk a little bit about, continue with a little bit about what archetypes in Itihasa, and at least start off with Karna. What do you want?
Yes, sir.
But what about the people who are hoping that you would say, let's go home? Sushtu. Okay. So let's take a little break. In fact, we'll say the closing prayer for this one. So that then you just get up, don't leave the room or get too excited. And just get up, sit down, take a stretch, and then we will start the other one, okay?
Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnah Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnamevavashishyate Om Shanti 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 Hari Om Shri Guru Namaha. Hari Om.
Get up, jump up and down, and sit down. So will you say now Big Wheel is home?
Swamiji, I just want to make an announcement.
Okay, great. I'm not sure.
Hello, I just want to make us
Vidyam Karamavahe Rekasvina Vahe Tamastuma Hidvishavahe Om Shanti Shanti Shanti.
This will be short. When we talk about the figure of Karna, we feel like asking, kya karna? What to do? Yeah. Who was Karna? Who is Karna? Unfortunately. But Karna was Kunti's son. Kunti had a boon. Yeah. Kunti had a boon. And what was the boon? That she could have any child from any devata just by looking at that devata. And so she had a wonderful eastward facing room with a balcony in the palace. And then she went out, she was a young princess. She went out and saw the rising sun after she was given this boon. And she said, oh, what a nice thing it would be to have a baby that looks just like the sun lord. Tathastu, so be it. And suddenly she was holding this resplendent child. And, she's unwed, unmarried, princess. Think of the scandal, And therefore can't afford to do this. And so, what did she do? Conveniently, she saw from the balcony, there was a nice river running through it, and the child had come. It's called Karna because he came with expensive gold earrings. He was already born with earrings. And then what happens is that he, what is going on there? Come. So, he had these beautiful earrings and she must have felt bad about it because no other option, what else to do? And she wrapped him. This is a kind of a universal tale of setting the baby adrift, wrapped him, swaddled it and put it in a makeshift, put the baby in a makeshift raft and let it float downstream. This is Karna's birth story. Then he was, the little raft was very sturdy and drifted downstream. And then it to a place where the charioteers, Rathakaras, were there. And what were the charioteers doing? They were, the women were washing the clothes. And one such childless woman who was really wanting a child, suddenly the baby is coming literally to her, where she's standing. And she's overjoyed. Her name is Radha. That's why Karna's another name is Radheya, the son of Radha. So then Radheya, is so Karna is, raised by Radha and her husband. They are charioteers, humble people, carpenters, charioteers, these kinds of people. And from the beginning, he is a misfit. Why misfit? Because he cannot, he feels that he doesn't belong among these people. He's bright, he's intelligent, he has frequent dreams of world domination, which is there from being the child of the sun lord, and which is there because he's princely. But here, the prince, so to speak, is being raised by commoners. Yeah. This is very, very important because, you know, this speaks to so many things. You know, it speaks to the immigrant experience. Neither if we belong here, it's all an allegory, a metaphor for, you know, immigrant experience, neither belonging here nor belonging there. Kind of a misfit, you know, in both places. And because one can never really go back home, so to speak. And what is home? This search for home and search for his people becomes a kind of a compelling story of his life. Compelling story of his life. And, you know, and so like most adopted children who know they are adopted, he begins to dig into his past and find out what is the story of my origins, who is my biological, who are my biological parents. And then he comes to know this whole story. Because it's at best an ill-kept secret, everybody knows, nobody talks about it, that he's actually the sixth, you know, lost Pandava. You know, it's a very interesting psychology because it's the psychology of a child, sad psychology to which everyone can relate, of a child feeling abandoned. This is something very, very interesting. An abandoned child psychology. There was even one movie made about this man who goes, I forgot the name of it. Huh?
Lion.
Yes. So I saw it on one of the planes. Yeah, so like that. So this search, it's a, you know, it's an abandoned child psychology because no matter how loving the charioteer couple was, and they were very loving, and he may not have riches and velvet and, you know, cushions and palaces, but he, you know, he had enough, and he went still. That early abandonment could not be cancelled out even after so many years of love. This is a psychological fact. This is a psychological order. But even after showering him with love, I mean, he didn't lack a mother. I mean, it's not that the, what is its name? The little makeshift boat drifted somewhere and got lost and he was raised by the wolves. Nothing like that. Or he had to search for food. Nothing. He went straight into the arms of this woman who had been wanting him. Who had no child of her own. So she was showered with love, but all that love could not cancel out the pain of the original abandonment. And that becomes his archetypical, you know, what should I say, the thorn in his side, in his life. And then what happens is that his whole life he wants to be loved, accepted, and needed. This is what he wants. He wants to be needed. He wants to be approved of. He wants to be, and not just approved of by anybody, approved of by the very princes whose upbringing he was entitled to but did not get. He wants their approval. He wants their love. And he wants to be okay in their eyes. You know? And this leads him to make some difficult choices. And here we see the pressure of the, you know, the pressure of this desire for approval seeking and the pressure of this insecurity to erase this insecurity and feeling of abandonment. We see the pressures operating to make him do wrong things and make him make mistakes. He was not a bad man. He just made bad choices. And one of the choices was to become Duryodhana's friend. Duryodhana says, you know, you see, there are friends who help to bring out the best in you. Being in their company, they encourage the best in you, you feel like a better person. And then there are those other friends who bring out, as it were, the worst in oneself. Absolute worst. Why? Because instead of putting water on the fires of insecurity and abandonment, and you know, Duryodhana would have easily pointed out, look at your adoptive parents. They are so loving. They are so great. They are so wonderful. Instead, he keeps on stoking the fears of insecurity by keeping on reminding him, you are abandoned. You are abandoned. You are, see, all these princes, how much they are getting to eat. And see, they all got, you know, Dronacharya as the teacher. See, they are going to, what is that called? Ivy League schools. And they are getting a quality education. And you are going to the public school with all the other sons and daughters of charioteers. What a life you are having. What a life you could be having. This is what he, Duryodhana keeps pointing out, what he is missing, what he is missing, what he is missing. And he eggs him on because he, Duryodhana is not interested in his welfare. So the psyche of his insecurity becomes a pawn for Duryodhana to use against his own agenda, his own war with the Pandavas, with the five princes. So he puts Karna as a bait, really, and uses him, uses the insecurity for his own ends. Go to Kunti, see if she'll accept you. See him in front of the whole assembly. He eggs him on. You know? Go to Kunti, go ask for this, go ask for that. And this is really his life. But you know, even though his life was distorted by a number of, you know, choices, mistakes, and this rankling feeling that he was not loved and he was not wanted, you know, he really tried to make the best out of his situation and compensate for this insecurity and abandonment. And how to compensate for this insecurity and abandonment? You know, how to get approval from everyone and how to feel wanted and needed. What does one do? Huh? You become a giver. Huh? Because when you give, people say, oh, nice. You become a giver. Not every giver is a Karna type giver, but and not every abandoned person who feels abandoned, you know, becomes a Karna. But here we see the two things dovetailing very, very nicely. Because Karna is, you know, wants to feel needed, approved and loved, and will do anything to get it. And the best way to feel wanted, needed, approved and loved is to give. You know, Dana Shila, he earned the epithet. You know, he is the one totally capable of and proficient in charity. He was a reckless giver. A giver, you know, he gave with abandon as though in the hope that would erase his abandonment. He just gave. Anybody who came, he gave, and he got a sense of identity from that giving, because that giver became his identity, because he got a sense of pride, because there was no other identity. He was neither a charioteer, nor was he acknowledged as the prince, as a prince. So what is his identity? He has to make an identity for himself. And so he came to be known as the quintessential giver. Gave. You see here the psychology of overcompensation. The desire to make a mark, this is all an allegory of the archetype here. The desire to make a mark in his own right, not to depend, because he was very independent. Blessed by the sun, you know, the sun doesn't need anyone else to shine. And similarly, Karna did not need anybody. He was independent, he was brilliant, and he thought about this. And this is not the only way to compensate. That's why I said, we cannot condemn him, because he made the best of his situation. He could also have become a notorious robber, but he didn't do that. He fell into bad company, unfortunately, because Duryodhana kept stoking his ego and his fears at the same time. You don't deserve this. You deserve better. Look at your mother. She is hugging Arjuna. And he created this rivalry with Arjuna, who was, you know, who was equal to him in many ways. Look at Arjuna. She is hugging him. Look, she made all these laddus just for Arjuna. You also like those laddus. Did you get any? No. See, you are entitled to those sweets. But you didn't get them. This is how he kept stoking the wrong thing in him. So on the one hand, we see a humble giver, because he took his giving seriously, and he used, and that's why it's like a split personality. On the one hand, we see someone who is towing the line of dharma, because in the Hindu dharma, one is asked to keep giving. So he gave everything, and kept on giving. And then what? On the other side, on the other hand, he was bristling, boiling with the anger that was difficult to control, because it was keeping on being fed by whittles of gossip, whittles of bad, you know, thoughts being kindled by Duryodhana and others. Because Duryodhana needed a way to taunt the Pandavas. This is what it happens. Then his fame, I mean, look at his, you know, sad situation, sad life. Because his fame as the giver keeps on growing. And then at the same time, we are close to the Mahabharata war. And then what? You know? Kunti is very nervous. Because even though he did not have an Ivy League education, Karna is equal to Arjuna in archery. He's wonderful. Very adept. And Kunti is worried that her favorite Arjuna will be killed in battle by no other person. No other person can come close to Arjuna except Karna. So she goes purposely after this puja and bath, bath and puja, because that's when he gives. Clever lady. First, you know, I mean, think of Kunti also. What kind of psychology it must be? Abandoned the baby, and the same baby she has the guts afterwards to go and say, spare my other baby's life. And he has a very fitting reply, because by this time the damage has been done. The damage has been done by this life, by this time. And what has happened? You know, he's too far gone in his anger, too far gone in his friendship. Who are we talking about? Karna. Too far gone in his anger, too far gone in his friendship to Duryodhana. Friendship means here loyalty, to be able to, and he's angry at Kunti. He's furious at Kunti, but he's a compulsive giver, because he gives in order to be accepted. And here, the only way, and Kunti is very clever, because Kunti goes and embraces him, and in the privacy of his house, for the first time calls him, oh my dear child, my long lost son. And with this kind of a preface, you only know what's coming next. What is this? The first chapter? First chapter is gimme, gimme, gimme. You know, she wants some. It is not out of a sense of motherly love that she has gone. She acknowledges him, as the son, and she, you know, even in her own way, apologizes for doing what she did, and she says, expresses her helplessness, and she says, I really did not have a choice. I was helpless. I had to put you downstream because I was not married, and how would I look after you? How would I explain your sudden presence? 1 minute I'm looking at the sun and another minute you are here in my arms. What do I do? You know, he says, fine, fine. Come to the point. You know, cut all the sweet talk. No more Madhuvidya for me. You know, tell me what you really want. What are you here for? Then she says, I have come for Bhiksha. I have come to beg of Arjuna's life. Please spare Arjuna's life. And what does he say? You have only and always acknowledged the existence of 5 sons. Before the war, what did you say? I have 5 sons, I'm the mother of 5 sons. And then she said, after the war also, I can promise you, you will still have 5 sons. Whether that 5th son is me or Arjuna, who knows? That's how he left it. And she had to go back. He could not do this. And actually it was, you know, a moment of reclaiming his strength for him, you know. And then of course, because he's in the wrong, he's following adharma, all these things happen, and then he's in a very compromised position because there is a piece of quicksand and the wheel gets caught in the sand. And he's ashastra panihi at that time. Ashastra panihi means what? The disarmed. Disarmed. And then according to warfare rules of olden days, you cannot hit somebody who is disarmed. Arjuna says, this is the time. Hit the arrow. You know? Sorry, Krishna tells Arjuna, this is the time. Hit the arrow. He's not telling Arjuna to follow adharma. It's his own karma, his own karmic profile that makes him stuck in this vulnerable situation. Therefore, the arrow pierces his chest, and then what? He's lying there in this bed of quicksand, which is also his death bed. Lying there, even then, is he allowed to die in peace? No. Why? When Brahmana comes, greedy Brahmana. You know, really, I when I read about this, he should have been beaten up and tied up. These Brahmanas also show up at the most inappropriate moment. Can't even let the fellow die in peace. And so this Brahmana shows up and says, oh, please give me something. Karna says, what? Don't you see? What do I have to give? Don't you see the arrow piercing the chest? What do I have to give? Actually, you know, you have accrued a lot of punya, giving, giving, giving. Can I have the punya? You know? Because which will take you to heaven, which will take you to wonderful lokas. Can I please have the punya? And Kanda, a weary, dying Karna says, take it, go for it. The irony is this, sad irony, so sad, that his identity as the giver, which would have probably earned him some, which earned him a little bit of a kudos in this life, and which should have given him a better gati in the next life, that was also snatched at the last minute because it was not fairly and squarely earned. It was a compulsive, because it was earned out of a certain compulsion. That is, you know, Karna's story. Very, very interesting story. Lot of nuances and lot of possibilities. Yesterday, what did you do? You wrote something, right? Yeah. So today, you can just discuss, you know, just break into twos and discuss what is the, you know, what parts of this psyche of Karna might you relate to and why? You know, what about this story for you hits home? What about this story touches the heart? Where are you sympathetic and where do you find yourself judgmental? You know, all this is, you can just discuss each way. You know, one person talks, other person listens, and then you switch after 5 minutes. And then the people online can just write here what part of the story is, you know, touches you, what part of the story impresses you. You can start now. Just 5 minutes you can discuss, okay? Yeah. pick somebody, doesn't matter who.
It's a pity that he was sad, even though he had parents who were taking care of him so much.
Yes, yes.
That was a bit of a...
Yes, but you see the same psychology you find in, you know, children who are adopted. In that film also it was very clearly shown. It is there.
But one good thing is, like you were saying, that he went into giving rather than going into violence.
Yeah, he could have gone into violence.
And here we see that a lot of
So he did a very good thing. He channeled it dharmically and very, very beautifully. It was very nice. You wanted to say something?
No, was that giving done clearly with a good intention, right? When he did it?
No, no. Good or bad, it's an outlet. It's an outlet whose the effect is acceptance. That's what he got.
Correct.
He wanted to be recognized. Yeah. He wanted to be recognized. He wanted it to be appreciated. He wanted approval. And he was not getting approval from... He thought he was deprived of the princely approval and princely upbringing. So he had to carve, and he was rejecting the charioteer upbringing. So he had to carve out for himself a new identity of being the quintessential giver. It's a psychological, you know, what is it called? It's called a coping mechanism.
Is that messenger saying that when you give, you don't just do it without string attached?
Nobody can give without string attached. Yeah. String is always there, sometimes it's invisible. That's all. Atmanastu kamaya sarvam priyam bhavati. Brihadaranyaka Upanishad says.
Without expecting anything.
No. That's not what it means. It means, this sentence, what I said, it means that when you give, you know, when you do something, you do it for being pleased. Yeah. You are happy when you give. You don't give so that the other person is better. You give because it makes you happy to give. Of course. It is very fine. Because through that you learn to give a little more freely, It makes him grow slowly.
But the fact that Paul was taken away at that point of the death.
Yes.
So where did Paul that, you think that he was doing the right thing
by
the time of death was taken away, so what does that imply?
It shows many things. What do you think it implies? Yeah, it could imply that. But then many people who do don't have the selfless intent. But it implied that what he was searching for, that identity is not got by giving. It was taken away because it was never his to begin with. This is not an identity to rest on.
With Kanda's story, there is a lot of circumstance that impacts him.
Yes.
Abandonment becomes the theme of his life.
Yes.
And it shapes what he does.
All his actions. Yes.
And so to a point he feels sympathetic because it's the person who was supposed to give him love and care.
Yes.
Was the very person who abandoned him.
Yes.
But then you realize that it was a function of his own choices.
Yes.
And that abandonment as a theme will come back to him in another life. In
another
form. Correct. As karma. And till he doesn't transcend that.
Yes.
Till he regardless of the good deeds or the giver he is.
It will keep revisiting him, very good point, until he resolves it. And this, you know, segues very well into this whole, what is asked online. Somebody asked me online, that did he get moksha after all this? I said, we don't know. We don't know if he got moksha. And
Krishna killed, if the Bhagavan killed, they say, anybody killed, but Bhagavan gets...
we say that, that's true. But here, technically Bhagavan said to kill, but Bhagavan did not kill. Not like, Narasimha. Narasimha,
I'd like to share this. This was an episode from TV on the show. One of the last scenes was after he shot, he was about to die. And he keeps on complaining to Krishna.
Yes.
This was treachery, this was not fair.
Yes.
In all his life, he has been subjected to
deceit.
Unfair.
Yes.
It is even unfair. Krishna listens to him at length, it was a long conversation.
Yeah.
Finally, he tells him. He says, you missed the entire point. He says, you were given a job. It was not an easy job, it was an immensely difficult job of fighting discrimination.
Yes.
And you are given enough talent and power to take that cause.
To undertake that.
He said, you fired the first shot against discrimination.
Yes.
And we will always remember you. He said, you missed the point completely.
Yes.
That was a beautiful conversation, I thought.
Oh, that's, yeah.
A great interpretation.
I didn't see that, but that sounds like a nice scene.
Yeah.
Yes. Thank you for sharing that. Yes.
It also reminds the character, the way the character, at least I interpret, is we all come with a baggage.
Yes.
We all have a vision of what we want to make our identity to be.
Yes.
And the challenge is in not accepting in the present of what our circumstances are and making the best out of it and intending to go in, you know, a different way than what. So, not being in the present and accepting that seems like a
costly mistake. Yeah, not being that was a costly mistake for him, because, you know, he tried to do good and he knew that going with Duryodhana was not the nicest thing, but he was addicted to flattery because, you know, the psychological theme of abandonment, unfortunately, can make one susceptible to flattery, isn't it? Ah. Become susceptible to flattery, somebody says, oh, you are wonderful. Oh, I forgot. Even the golden earrings which are attached to his ears, he had to cut off a piece of his ears to bring it, take it out, because he was born with them. They had grown into the flesh of the ears. That also somebody asked and took. I forgot.
Even
Yeah. Indra or the sun?
Surya.
Surya said, give me back my earrings. And that also he had to give back. So, and also it's a, you know, it's not just a punishment that he could not take what he, all the punya. It's a fact of life. What can you take other than self-knowledge, which blesses you to know that there is really nothing to take. What can you take? What, you know, at the time of death, what can you take? Nothing. What can you give? Nothing. And so he got a instant and a hard lesson in non-doership, akartritva. But he is not the karta. Yes.
I have a question. I have two questions. So first, he was Arjun aware that Kanda was his own brother?
Yeah, yeah. They all knew. It was kind of an ill-kept secret. Yeah. They all knew.
Okay. The second question is, why did Krishna say that Arjun or advise Arjun to release the arrow and take?
Because from the standpoint, from the view of Krishna, he, you know, he knew the inevitability of the fact that Karna was going to die because he had Divya Drishti. He could tell, because he is Bhagavan, he could tell. Krishna ji could tell that this is what his end is going to be. And the end could be accomplished in an easy way. You know, there was many other things that were done, like for example, the start of the war, that's another thing, because the start of the war, you know, this one, what is that, Sahadeva, who is Sahadeva? One of the Pandavas. He was very skilled in astrology, my God, he was a great astrologer and a very impartial one. And so, you know, of course, Arjuna goes, you know, Yudhishthira goes to Sahadeva and says, which is the time for us to be successful in battle, he gives. Duryodhana also goes to Sahadeva, when can I fight against you? Please write the correct muhurtam, because I would like to win the war and kill you. Sahadeva is so such a sadhu, he gives.
And when Krishna says whatever must have happened, he gives the exact instances where
yes. Yes. He didn't. Yeah. No, but that's not. I'm illustrating what she said just now. I did not protest. Correct. But coming back to this point, then, you know, Duryodhana said, "We want to start the war at our time when we are going to win." And Krishna simply said, "Okay, And then what happened? You know, he made it so that he put the hourglass, you know, two minutes away. Something happened. He made it so that it would be just a little later when the thought, because it would not happen. Is this cheating? This is not cheating. Because it is the act of Bhagavan, and it is one's own karma phala coming back. It is one's own karma phala in the form of these actions. So it's not that Bhagavan is bad, Bhagavan is not following dharma, Bhagavan is doing wrong things. No, Bhagavan is not doing wrong things. He's allowing them to happen because in the scheme of things, this is how it had to be. So the one that was always afraid of deceit and treachery has a sad, ironic end at the hands of deceit and treachery. You know? And the one that is always interested in building an identity has that very identity in the form of punya that can be taken to another realm, snatched away by a greedy brahmana. Like that. That is, it's we don't get caught up in the characters. We have to understand the significance of it. Yeah. And so, and if you hobnob, like you said, with the likes of Shakuni and what was his name, Duryodhana, and then you don't speak up against injustice. You know, what is the use of being a giver if you're not able to talk or not able to speak up? Many ways he could have become a robber. He could have, you know.
In the right way.
I think that, you know, to understand that heavy as this parentage is, you know, it is he can find, he would have studied Vedanta. Yeah, that is the best way. Study Vedanta. Got disappointed in, you know, in his identity being eroded. And then study Vedanta to understand that I am not just a sum total of all my identities and the crown on my head which should have been there, which is not there. I am not that. I am much more than that. I am Satchidananda. That is what he should have understood. Even with or without Vedanta, there is ways to come to at least a little bit of a semblance of that. And knowing, he could not see that the security was not in approval seeking. This is a very good lesson for all of us. No approval seeking, because approval is very, very temperamental. And one becomes a slave of somebody's approval. And if that person is actually disapproved by the entire society and I am seeking their approval, what does that make me? This is what happens. That is the lesson here. Anything else? Yeah.
Something you talk at extent about the abandonment with regard to Karna. But what about Kunti? Is it because it was a celestial birth? Had it been a biological birth, would she have felt the pangs of her son? How would that have been?
We don't know. But nonetheless, you know, all we know is that what is written there and expressed in the Mahabharata is that for her princely upbringing as an unwed princess, she's not going to, you know, come out with suddenly with a baby and try to look after it. She was playing with the boon. She was just playing with the boon. She was just like, oh, rising sun, look, oh nice. Wonder what that one's baby will look like. Suddenly Karna was in her arms. What is she going to do? No?
With Kunti, the karma of abandoning her baby?
Certainly. Absolutely. Yeah. To a certain extent. You know, but then again, from the standpoint of actions, this is an action which everybody can connect with. Because if the baby is not wanted, you know what else to do? This is the, in a way, it was a responsible thing to do. She also did the right thing, in a way. She did not, you know, kill it. She had compassion for it. She prayed over it. She gave it all the love, whatever she could. And then she made sure that it would go to a place of safety. So this was the older days, ancient ways of giving up, you know, for adoption. And she followed what was there, the practice in those times. So she cannot be blamed for that.
It reminds me of the Kabirda story.
Yeah, so many things, Moses, Kabir, Das, everybody has some, you know, there is some kind of a similar trajectory here. Yeah.
I think it's very important to understand the actions of Bhagavan.
Yes.
The true spirituality and the spirit, because otherwise it can be misinterpreted.
Yeah, it is misinterpreted.
A lot of times.
Yeah.
That how can Bhagavan do this? Even in Ramayana,
yeah,
he asks Sugriva to wear a garland and Rama is Purushottama. How
yes.
can he do this?
But he is not doing it. It is
yeah.
to show that their own karma phala is coming back in yeah. certain ways. Yeah. And the eclipse comes and then
yeah,
he says
right.
the day
sunset,
is gone, sunset,
yeah.
but the sun is not set. 2 minutes later, it you know, the eclipse clears and he says, okay. Shoot the arrows. Ashwatha, Mohana, Naroba, Kunjaroba, you know. Ashwatthama has been killed and he makes Yudhishthira announce on the battlefield, because if he announces, nobody will even believe. Because Krishna is known to be Tribhangi, standing like this, very wavy fellow. So, nobody will believe him. So, he makes the most truthful person in the battlefield say, Ashwatha, Mohataha. Ashwatthama has been killed. Who is Ashwatthama? Depends. No, depends. It is the name of an elephant in the battlefield. It's also the name of the heartbeat of Drona. You know, where his heartbeat resides in his son, Ashwatthama. So, who knows who is killed? And then, you know, he gives him a megaphone and says, make the announcement. And Yudhishthira says, only on the condition that I can say Narova, Kunjarova at the end. I don't know if it's the man or the elephant.
Yeah.
He says, sure, you can make the announcement. But suddenly, he snatches away the megaphone and then Narova, Kunjarova, nobody hears. Only Ashwatthama, Hataha. Oh, Yudhishthira is saying, the one who never tells a lie. OMG. And then everybody believes. And then, yeah, and Duryodhana just sinks, literally. And that becomes a very winning moment, really. And then, even though he followed Krishna's sayings, Yudhishthira gets a small papa karma for saying this one lie. Because he goes to heaven and he's surprised to see Arjuna, Duryodhana is sitting there being fed peeled grapes and being fanned by apsaras. What are they? Menaka and Urvashi on either side. And he tears start rolling from his eyes. He said, I'm the most depressed I expected to see. What's the use of it? So, and to see this darshanam, what have I done? I could have had so much fun. Oh, I didn't do any of those things for this. And now I'm seeing this fellow who's done everything under the book. And the Paricharaka, the Sevak in heaven, explains. He says, well, because you remember that lie you said, Ashwatthama. And so here, your punishment is here. Your punishment is to see him enjoy. Because there's no suffering worse than seeing him enjoy. Why is he here? How did he even qualify here? Well, the sevak, heavenly sevak, celestial sevak says, you know, if you have done something small, that you have to undergo first. So accidentally he did a good turn, you know, maybe by giving Karna a little boost. That's why he's in heaven for 5 minutes. Because by the time he enjoys his smoothie, he will be pushed down. Yeah, he won't even finish his smoothie, you watch. And then he said, okay, that aside, where are my people? They are in hell. What? They are in Naraka. Why? Because they had done various things. And then he says, I don't want to enjoy heaven without them. Take me there. So he's taken there to the nether world, where Draupadi he finds being stretched out with a stretching machine, you know. And she's screaming, ayo, ow, in all languages she's saying, ouch. And then, you know, he's again, you know, Yudhishthira cries. And then he says it is, and he's told, it is for having participated in the war that did not leave any survivors practically. Other than Parikshit, who was left? Nothing. And Parikshit also died after 1 week. Ah, kaun bacha? Koi nahi bacha. So So he said, this is the cause of this, but since you are truthful, it is washed off. So then he has to watch that for 5-10 minutes, and then they supposedly ascend to heaven. Interesting story, you know. Yeah, it gives a lot of pause for thought. If Duryodhana can make it to heaven, you know, we have a lot of don't Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnamah Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vasishyate Om Shanti 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 Hari Om Shri Vasudevaya Namah Hari Om.
Do you want?
Yeah, tomorrow morning 5740 something reserve. Seven. And then tomorrow evening 5 o'clock, not 6 o'clock, not 7 o'clock. Yeah. And then 6:30 we have a little performance for the children. Yes.
Tomorrow 8:30 in the morning. Rudram.
Yeah. So then there is something here when that is denied. Okay. Some interesting comments here. The need for connection is there. Driving motivation for most of us, when that is denied due to prarabdha or whatever, then I feel that the glow keeps one open for true connection, which is to Bhagavan, yes, which is the blessing of Vedanta. Kunti as a mom comes along with human fallibilities, and so that's a pity. And then Karna did try making lemonades from the lemons life gave him. And then Andrew from Australia says that a glass of lemon juice daily is good for the body-mind complex. On that note, we will stop. Come and get prasad.